about this creature from other hunters, but they assumed it was just a myth. And as the hours passed without incident, they had no reason to believe otherwise.
Hey, boy.
Everything changes the moment they get back to their camp. Someone, or more accurately, something has been there.
Oh, wait, one, this one. You didn't see it. You
damn
see.
Damn bears.
It was watching them, you will see.
Look.
The two veterans of the wilderness have no clue what kind of creature has invaded their camp. Whatever it is, it's enormous and walks upright on two legs.
Buck's got to weigh 300 pounds.
Didn't get up there by himself.
The mountain men must face the cold, hard truth. They're trespassers in the domain of a beast, the likes of which they have never encountered. And it's a natural-born killer.
It was a deer. Ripped stem to stern. Laying up in the branch. No animal can do that.
Legends are born out of human need to provide an explanation for the unexplained. But let's be clear, Bauman's story is far more than a precautionary tale.
We went on back to camp.
When the darkness set in that night, an uneasy sense came over he and Jones, as if they're being watched by menacing eyes.
It's not long before they can feel the creature. It's so close, they can smell it.
Smell is the most primal of our senses. It's often our first warning of danger, something no one should ignore.
Smell worried him enough to get up and take a shot, causing the creature to retreat. But whatever it was, made it known clearly that it was not happy.
I believe the creature's sounds were a deliberate effort to talk these men. It was almost like psychological warfare. And it was working. These mountain men had spent their whole lives as hunters. And now, the shoe's on the other foot. They were in the crosshairs of a monster.
I'm not sure what it was, gentlemen. We were mystified. We did not know what was becoming of us. Next day, I was out looking for this beast. I remember I stopped at a stream and reaching down in the stream, fill my canteen, and I see a silhouette in the water. Look up. Nothing there.
Thank you.
fast I could. Then I see the beast.
We've all heard the phrase, a fate worse than death. One definition of that fate is to see death coming, know it will be horrifying, and yet be powerless to stop it.
The amazing thing about this encounter is it's consistent with the key elements of every Bigfoot sighting. It's said to have happened over 160 years ago. That would make this one of the earliest Bigfoot sightings ever chronicled. The huge footprints, the 8-foot-tall hairy biped, the horrible stench, it checks all the boxes. And very importantly, this account is handed down to us by Teddy Roosevelt. As credible a source as you could ask for.
Gentlemen, I don't know what it was. The smell of it. A horrible smell. The sound of it. I'll never forget it.
Bauman's story leaves the hunting party speechless. Roosevelt himself wonders, is it the truth or a tall tale?
I could prove this to you. Look here, Mr. Roosevelt. Check that out right there. Look at the butt end of it there. That hair is from that beast. If he's still out there, we're in for a world of trouble.
Roosevelt writes that Bauman's account truly impressed him. Who knew that one of our greatest presidents would be a key part of a Bigfoot narrative?
Mr. Reagan? It's sack time, sir.
No story haunted Roosevelt's memory like Bauman's, in which the pursuers had become the prey.